Today on the 2020 Awards podcast, lucky us, we are joined by Lucky Them director Megan Griffiths. I asked Megan what film has inspired or influenced her, and she asked us to revisit one of my all-time favorite films, Midnight Run.
Why aren't you popular with Chicago Police Department?
That's something that really doesn't concern you.
She hurt you, Janet?
Yeah.
I'm sorry.
What are you sorry about?
I'm sorry you're hurt.
I'm not hurt.
You just said you were hurt.
I'm not hurt.
You just said you were hurt.
I didn't say I was hurt. You said I was hurt.
I asked you if you were hurt, and you said, yeah, I'm hurt.
That's because you made me say. You're starting to put words in my mouth.
Jack, you're a grown man. You have control over your own words.
You're goddamn right I do. So here come two words for you. Shut the fuck up.
Midnight Run was released in 1988, written by George Gallo and directed by Martin Brest. It's the story of a bounty hunter played by Robert De Niro who has to transport an accountant played by Charles Grodin who stole money from the mob from New York to Los Angeles. He has 5 days to meet a midnight deadline or he loses his bounty of $100,000. Meanwhile, they're being pursued by a second bounty hunter, the mob who wants to kill Grodin, and the FBI agent who will nullify De Niro's score if they bring him in. Our guest today is director Megan Griffiths. Megan was born in Ohio and raised in Idaho, returning to the Midwest to attend Ohio University School of Film. Megan has been a vital part of the Seattle film community, as shown by her role on the board of directors at the Northwest Film Forum, her Genius Award for film as presented by The Stranger in 2012, and her recognition as one of the City Arts Magazine's Artist of the Year in 2013. Lucky Them is her fourth feature and debuts at Seattle International Film Festival Thursday night, May 22nd at 7 p.m. at the Renton IKEA Performing Arts Center. I hear they have great furniture there.
Oh, really?
The seats are really nice.
IKEA furniture?
Yeah. And then screens again Friday night, May 23rd, 9 p.m. here in Seattle at the Egyptian Theater. Welcome to the show, Megan.
Hello, thank you.
This is good. I've been hoping to get you on the show for a long time. So.
Yeah, totally.
Lucky them. Tell us what's the plot?
It's about a music journalist played by Toni Collette, who is given an assignment by her editor, played by Oliver Platt, to go track down this musician who disappeared mysteriously 10 years previous, and it is complicated by the fact that this musician was the love of her life, and when he left the rest of the world, he also left their relationship. So
She
has a lot of sort of baggage from that she's never really tended to, and she's been living a bit of a sort of repeated cycle.
Okay.
And sort of bedding young musicians and staying out late and waking up hungover, and so she's sort of stuck in that phase of her life and hasn't really moved past it. And so getting this assignment encourages her to she sort of grudgingly takes it.
Sure.
Sort of her job is on the line at this point because it's a print magazine too, so things are bleak and they need a big attention grabbing story.
Right.
And so this is what she gets. And then she is accompanied on this quest by this eccentric, wealthy, aspiring documentarian played by Thomas Hayden Church. And so there's a little odd couple energy to the movie too. That in this, it's no Midnight Run, but Midnight Run is a movie that Emily, the writer producer of Lucky Them, it's the movie that we most agree on in terms of loving it.
Yeah.
So it's kind of funny that we're talking about both. But
Emily
Wachtel is the woman who wrote Lucky Them, and she's a producer.
This is based on her life.
It's semi-autobiographical.
Okay.
She was written by her 10, 11 years previous to
was
us
a book
shooting
first?
It. It was never a book.
Okay.
It was originally a reality show and then a regular, a narrative TV show, I think, and then eventually became a feature script. Emily was raised, she's very close friends with Clea Newman, who's Paul Newman's daughter, and Joanne Woodward's. And they at a certain point in the process, maybe I don't know, 7-8 years ago, before Paul passed away, Emily passed him the script, and he was very encouraging and offered to help out in any way that he could. And he was the person who sent the script to Thomas Hayden Church,
right?
And I think Tom still has the letter framed, because who wouldn't,
right? And, yeah, exactly.
And he was attached for 6 years, Tom, and then. Fast forward till 2 years ago, I came on board. Just because they had been working with a co-writer, director, this guy named Huck Botko.
Wait, what?
Huck Botko?
I thought you said Huck Bucko.
Huck Bucko. All right. He probably gets that sometimes. But anyway, he's a writer-director who was originally attached, and he dropped out of the project, and they were looking for a director. And my friend, Emily and I's mutual friend, Colin Trevorrow, who directed Safety Not Guaranteed, kind of connected the dots and told Emily he thought I'd be a good fit for it. And I read the script and really loved it and the characters. And Emily and I got along, both love Midnight Run. So, you know, let's make a movie.
Midnight Run brought us together. As I said, Midnight Run. I love Midnight Run.
Me too.
Why did you pick this?
Well, I've had a long love affair with this movie, as many friends can tell you. In fact, my rap gift from the executive producer of Lucky Them was a Midnight Run poster, because I talk about it a lot.
Oh, really? Nice. Yep.
And it was the first rated R movie I ever saw in the theater. I was too young to go to rated R movies, and my friend's dad let us come with him. So we had a guardian. And I have been a fan ever since. I loved it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's so funny that this was rated R.
I know. I mean, well, there's a lot of profanity.
There's a lot of profanity.
Like sex or some violence, but not. It's not particularly real violence, but it's. I think it's rated R because of Robert De Niro's like slews of profanity.
Yeah. I mean, I'm sure that isn't it something like you get two F words and then beyond that it becomes an R.
Yeah.
That makes sense. You saw it when you were a wee lad, lass. Wee lad. Oh, I can't talk. You saw this when you were very young.
I don't remember being a wee lad, but...
I've never said wee lass before. So it's like it always comes out as wee lad. So you saw this when you were a kid, right?
I did.
And so what was your...
I don't think how old I was, but
was it exciting because it was R-rated, or was it just...
It was probably both. It's one of those things where I think I watched it again... You know, later on, and I think I've appreciated it in different ways since I was a kid. You know, and I think I liked it then because I was like, "Oh my God, they're cussing!" You know, it's funny. Like I love Charles
because you cuss so much.
Oh yeah, little potty mouth. Anyway, Charles Grodin's character is so. Dry and deadpan. It's like the comic chemistry in the movie is so great. It's just, I don't know, it's just one of those things that I enjoy it every time. And I've been introducing it to people recently, and they've been reconfirming that I am not crazy. And it's not all nostalgia based. It's definitely legitimately good.
Yeah.
Film. Yeah.
But there, you know, I mean, you bring up a great point, which is, I think, it's the classic comedy formula. It's an odd couple.
Mm-hmm.
You've got Charles Grodin, who's kind of very dry and has his act together, so to speak. He's the voice of reason. And then you got De Niro, who is basically a walking ulcer. You know, he's just constantly like, Grodin even says it in the film, it's like you have two modes of expression. It's either, you know...
Silence and rage.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. But they play so well off each other.
Yeah.
And there's like at least a half dozen scenes in the film of Grodin sort of feeding off of De Niro's personality.
Right, yeah.
There's a scene where they go to, is it the Western Union office? And he's trying to get some money, or he's trying to buy, I think he's trying to buy a bus.
Oh, right. There's a great scene when he's trying to buy a bus ticket, and the woman behind the counter like catches him in a lie because he's using a fake FBI badge.
Right.
And doesn't have his real name on it.
Yeah.
And so he's trying to like talk his way out of it, and Charles Grodin's just behind him making these facial expressions.
Yeah,
like, he's like totally on the side of the bus. You know, you're doing your job. Good
right.
job, lady.
Yeah, yeah. He's like, awesome. Oh yeah, this guy. He's. I'm glad you caught him.
He's like, tell me about it, sister. You know.
Yeah,
their chemistry is like pretty amazing, considering it's the only movie I think they ever did together. And I read on Wikipedia today that the original studio, which I think was Paramount, wanted to replace that character with, they wanted somebody else who was sort of marketable and would drive audience members to go see the movie instead of Grodin. So they were suggesting switching it to a female character and having it be played by Cher, which I think is the weirdest idea.
Oh my God, really?
It is hard to imagine that movie. Sure. And then the other person, when they decided to keep it a male, the other person that they were talking about was Robin Williams, which I also think
It's
just such different films.
Wow.
So I'm happy that Martin Brest stuck to his guns and got Grodin, who is just like, I think I don't know if, I mean, I don't think De Niro's ever been as funny as he is in this movie.
No, I don't think so either.
Even when he's trying to be in sort of later movies, when he's sort of like poking fun when at all he's of his in other, like
official
analyze
comedy.
This. And,
yeah,
you know, this,
yeah.
He's like usually he's kind of sending up his persona
right.
in a more of a parody. And I just think this is like when he's, it's sort of like still in his persona, but it's working as in a comic way.
Right.
It's the most sort of authentic comedy I feel like he's ever had.
I totally agree with you. And I think that...
And he looks great, too.
He does, actually. It's, you know, it's funny you mentioned that, because I have a friend back when that movie came out that kind of looked a little bit like De Niro. A little shorter, though, but, like, he didn't quite have, like he wore his hair a little bit longer and stuff. I was like, you should cut your hair like this and, like, get yourself a nice leather jacket. It's like they're kind of trying to restyle
it's a good
him.
Look. He's yeah. got like a uniform in the movie, basically.
Yeah.
Like the leather jacket yeah. and jeans. It's still kind of, it's pretty timeless.
It is. No, it's that's funny you bring that up. Yeah, but he does. I mean, it's like he I also think, you know, the great thing I think about this movie is it's not really a comedy per se, right?
Yeah.
Like it's kind of got dramatic lighting.
Yeah. I love the way it looks, actually.
It does.
Really
it looks
well
fantastic,
shot.
Yeah.
Yeah.
There's that scene where they're going to the airport, and Grodin is basically going to... There's like a big handoff that's about to happen. De Niro's going to give the mob boss some fake discs that he believes has incriminating evidence on it in exchange for Grodin, who he's trying to deliver to New York, or to L.A. And then... but there's that moment right before... The handoff happens in Farina's limousine.
Did you actually think that you were going to steal my money and get away with it? I stopped by here to tell you two things. Number one is that you're going to die tonight. Number two, I'm going to go home, have a nice hot meal. I'm going to find your wife. And I'm going to kill her, too.
There's nothing funny about it.
Mm-mm.
There's...
It's,
know,
like,
it's it
cold.
Looked like, if you just saw that scene in out of context, you'd go, like, oh, you know, is this, like, Goodfellas Part 2?
Right.
You know? And, yeah, I feel like the whole movie does a great job of having that balance, because...
Yeah.
It just, yeah, it doesn't play anything for laughs. I mean,
yeah. I like things that are more than one genre. So many things are just, like, kind of built to fit into a specific genre, and it gets a little tiresome. And,
yeah.
like, I'm, you know, there are definitely other movies in sort of the broader action comedy world,
mm-hmm.
and I tend to, like, they tend to be my preferred action movies if I'm going that direction.
Right, yeah.
I read... Ebert's review called this movie a thriller, which I think is a stretch.
That's kind of weird.
Yeah, but I think that it's definitely, you know, it does has a lot of sort of big action set pieces. I mean, there's like exploding helicopters
right.
and like chase scenes and big like
and
huge
those are kind of my
scenes.
Least favorite scenes though.
Yeah,
like the whole helicopter thing is like I actually feel like that's where it kind of gets too broad.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there's a lot of them like screaming and
yeah.
but even then, you know, there's great stuff in it where like Grodin's like, you guys are the worst bounty hunters I've ever seen. You know, but yeah, it's I don't know, it's I think any comedy that has like its roots in something deeper,
yeah.
which is I think this movie really does. You know. Deserves a lot more credit because
yeah.
I feel like, you know, again, this seems to be a recurring theme, and I think comedies never really get the credit they deserve because it's like, well, it's just a dumb comedy, but
right.
it's like, no, you can say a lot.
Yeah, I mean, there's you can do character development in any kind of movie,
yeah.
which is forgotten by a lot of people.
Right. Yeah.
This movie has that's I think that's probably what I love so much about it is that the characters are really strong and
mm-hmm.
complex and non-one-dimensional. Like they, you know, like De Niro is an ex-cop who's now a bounty hunter, but he's also like he's got this whole backstory with his wife and sort of
yeah.
Like he was going to be this cop who took down Serrano, the Dennis Farina character,
yeah.
at one point in his history, and he just got completely screwed by his like corrupt.
Police friends, yeah,
friends.
Yeah,
and so then he ended up in this life that he doesn't particularly like, but he's was sort of this unhappy character, and something about being paired with this other guy who's got these like strong moral ideals kind of brings that back out of him too, and he's
but De Niro has the strong moral ideals, which is why he's in the position
but he's
in.
Become so embittered by like his life and his position and where he's ended up that I think like being with this other guy who reminds him of that just kind of like it's sort of he sort of begrudgingly. He just his respect for him just kind of grows and grows and grows, and it makes him better. And
well, I think Grodin basically is a reflection of himself. Mm-hmm. I think that's what's there's a great scene on the train where they're having dinner.
Why would you eat that?
Why? Because it tastes good,
but it's not good for you.
I'm aware of that.
Well, why would you do something that you know that's not good for you?
Because I don't think about it.
Well, that's living in denial.
Living in denial?
Yeah.
I'm aware of that.
So you're aware of all your behavior, yet you continue to do things that aren't good for you. That sounds sort of foolish, don't you think so, Jack?
No. Stealing $15 million from Jimmy Serrano sounds foolish.
I don't think I get caught.
Now that's living in denial.
And it's a nice, two sides of the same coin scene without that... that line that you hear so often, it's like, you and I are alike, or we're not so different, or whatever it is, but it's like, it's done without any of that stuff, and I just love the movie, because it does stop and have scenes like that.
Mm-hmm.
It's not afraid to do that.
Yeah, and those are the best moments, but I mean, honestly, you probably couldn't have a movie that was exclusively just the two of them sitting talking,
right?
But it is so good when it happens in this movie that it almost feels like you could just run the whole movie that way.
Yeah.
And they're just really great together, and the characters work so well together. But yeah, it's built up with all this other sort of stuff that keeps other people, keeps it exciting.
Right. Yeah. Yeah. There is like a shootout every 10 minutes or so.
Yeah. There's a lot of nefarious activity and like intertwining motives and.
The script for this is so good.
Yeah.
I mean,
and the other character, like the people who were the two like mob henchmen who are just like total like idiots.
Mooks.
Yeah.
Total goons, mooks.
Yeah, they are they're funny. And Marvin Bowman, who's the other
bounty hunter
Paul Ashton, is that his name?
Yeah.
Is that right? John Ashton.
John Ashton, right.
He's so great. Like, it's just so well cast all around. The guy who plays the FBI agent is Yaphet Kotto,
yep.
And that guy is amazing.
And
just
his
like,
subordinates are great, too.
Yeah. It's just like...
Joe Pantoliano.
Joey Pants.
Yeah.
Yeah, as the bail bondsman.
Yeah.
It's funny because I love this movie so much that when... Even like many, many, many years later, when Gigli came out, I was like, I'm going to go see that in the theater because Martin Brest directed it. And, he also did Beverly Hills Cop. And, he's got a lot of good movies under his belt. But, wow.
Yeah.
That one is, he's not unfailable, I guess.
Yeah.
Infallible, whatever
yeah.
the word is.
No, it's did he do Gigli?
Mm-hmm.
Did he really?
Wrote and directed.
What was the Kevin Smith one? Didn't he do that?
Oh no, that was a different movie. That was the other J-Lo Ben Affleck movie that Kevin Smith did. I can't remember what that one's called.
Yeah.
So they came out like in the same year.
Right.
They're both
okay.
terrible.
Yeah. Oh, that's funny. I didn't realize that. Huh. Oh, well. Yeah. No. Yeah, it's funny. Like those mob goons, they're so great. And just like, the whole thing where Farina calls them up and one of the guys answers like, hey, is this idiot number one or moron number one? Put moron number two on the phone. And, it's like, he's not mad at me, is he?
He seems pissed,
Yeah. And even, the costume design. Like, there's, what's his name? Farina.
He's always wearing these, Cosby sweaters.
Yeah, these weird Cosby sweaters. But there's one that's got, a giant knot on the stomach.
Mm-hmm.
And it was, very nice,
It's a good touch.
Yeah. I think my favorite scene, though, is when he goes back to visit his ex-wife.
Mm-hmm.
And then his daughter.
It's such a heartbreaking scene. It's like he's been not contacting these people for a while out of
pride.
For nine years.
He goes, I haven't seen these people for 9 years.
And it's really because he's he's too proud to go back. And when he finally goes back, he has to ask them for money and help. And, it's just heartbreaking. And, of course, they still love him and they want to help him. And the wife gives him her car. And then the daughter comes out with her little jar of babysitting money.
Yeah.
And he just won't take it.
Yeah.
And it's a great moment.
It is. It's beautiful. It's it really gets me every time. Because they're screaming at De Niro and his ex are screaming at each other.
And then they
and then suddenly there's like this moment where he turns and looks, and it's like somebody else is in the room, and it's his daughter.
Yeah.
And she's like 14 or whatever it is, and it's beautiful.
It's good.
Yeah.
And it's like they, it really earns all its moments.
It
like,
does. It's like it earns it. Yes.
Like you, they don't just throw these things at you all of a sudden where you're supposed to like feel for people and you don't, they don't care. They really like you. By the time you get to that moment, it's like you care about him.
Yeah.
You know, he's not a bad guy.
No, it's true. And there's a great, there's a tiny little detail where you start to see him starting to turn and become like more respectful of Grodin is when they get in the car, leaving the ex-wife's house, and Grodin's coattail is hanging out of the door, and he grabs it and he puts it in, or De Niro, you know,
yeah.
De Niro grabs and puts it in before he closes the door. And it's just like such a nice little moment where it's like he's starting to take care of him now.
And then it ends, and then like, you know, also the other sort of big moment that feels so earned is at the end. I'm assuming there's, we don't have to worry about spoilers.
No, you know, the movie's from 88.
It's that moment at the end where it's like he gets, he finally gets him there and he's going to succeed. And that's all he really is like.
Right.
He's all about pride and like, you know, doing his job well. And so he really just, like, he has all these opportunities to sell him out, sell Gordon's character out. And like the mob offers him all this money and he's just, you know, there's all of this financial reward in it for him if he gives him up at any given point, and he never does. And then at the end he gets him there, he knows he would have succeeded, and he takes the handcuffs off and he lets him go.
Yeah.
And then Grodin pulls out the $300,000 that he's just had strapped to him the entire time.
Yeah.
And hands it off to him. So he does kind of succeed in the end, but it's like such a, there, the moment that between the two of them there at the end is like so awesome.
It is. It's, yeah, it's great. You know, it's funny, I just watched Butch Cassidy recently, or you know, seen it again, and this reminded me a lot. It kind of had the same tone too, you know, like that sort of
bromance,
you know, two guys on the run, but you know, kind of an action film, but kind of a comedy.
Totally. And oh, that's interesting.
Yeah, but yeah, you know, it's funny seeing, one of the things I loved about Butch and Sundance was just like there was no sentimentality in it, you know, but you knew these guys loved each other,
right?
And the ending of that movie, you know, it's like they go out and you know, nearly get killed trying to get more ammo off their horses, and you know, Butch's or Sundance is like, you call that running? And he's like, you call that coverage? You know, you call it shooting or whatever? And, and it's just nice because you know really what they're saying is, I love you. And there's a similar moment in Midnight Run where they're on the train riding in the cargo.
Yeah, it's, they jump a train like a bunch of hobos, and
somewhere in the back of my mind, I keep thinking we're gonna wind up together again. I don't know why. I'm still hanging on. I'm still waiting around. I don't think she's coming back. Yeah, I don't either. Sometimes you just have to let go. Just get yourself a new watch. You're okay, Jack. I think, under different circumstances, you and I probably still would have hated each other.
Subtext is really clear, and you know what's going on.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. The other thing I really liked about this that Martin Brest did, I feel like this is kind of a dying art form with directors, but I understood the context and geography of everything that was happening in the scene. And there's some scenes where you've got, you know, 30 police cars and a helicopter, and you know, and then there's other scenes, you know, where you've got train cars and guys with machine guns and stuff. But it was always very clear. You always understood exactly, like, where everybody was.
Mm-hmm.
And I feel like a lot of times, like, even that final scene at the airport, it's really nicely directed.
That's a good point. I never really thought about that, because it is complicated in
it's
a lot.
It's very complicated.
Because there are so many different people who converge.
So many moving parts,
yeah. And you do always have a good sense of, like, and the... You, there's, it, you know, the whole plot with the discs and the handoff, and it's a little bit complicated, but yeah. it's kind of handled in a very sort of efficient,
it
easy,
is. Yeah.
easily understood kind of way. It's just like, I don't remember ever having a problem with it, even when I was young and yeah. I didn't understand anything
yeah.
like that.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah, and I feel like a lot of times I'll go see newer movies now and I'm like, where are we? You
yeah.
know, and so anyway, and I thought, because there are so many moving parts in this.
Yeah, I don't know. Do you happen to know what the budget was for this movie?
It
it takes place over I don't know how many states, and it's got
right.
it's got like almost a Blues Brothers-esque police yeah. car like destruction scene where they're
yeah.
like in this chase
oh, right.
and
yeah, yeah.
in the sort of the brush and cop cars are just dying left and right,
yeah.
like being flipped, and
they're on trains, they're on biplanes,
yeah.
they're on
yeah.
jet planes.
It
yeah.
is insane, and it just feels like it must have been such a mammoth production.
Oh, I know. So I watch stuff like that, and I go like, how do they get their head around that?
Yeah,
yeah.
It is kind of amazing that the studio would have greenlit. I mean, I'm assuming what it was probably a pretty huge budget at the time with someone like Grodin.
Right.
De Niro, for sure. He
yeah.
was, I think, just off Untouchables when he did this movie.
But had Martin Brest done much before this? He had done
Beverly Hills
yeah,
Cop.
Yeah, right.
Yeah,
right, right.
So, yeah, he probably brought a little financing to the table.
Right. Yeah.
That movie did all right.
It did okay. Yeah. The running gags through this movie are so good. You've got the whole Mosley.
Yeah, Alonzo Mosley, FBI. Yeah.
The identity of Mosley.
I'm Mosley.
Yeah. Grodin not flying.
Yep.
The sunglasses disappearing and reappearing. De Niro's watch not working, although that's more of a thematic thing, but
yep.
still beautifully done. And then Mosley always stealing Marvin's cigarettes.
Yep.
It's, yeah.
It's so great.
Yeah.
The sunglasses thing, too, and they reference it. Like, in the first scene that he deals with the FBI people, he's just like, he looks around and he's like surrounded by them, and they're all basically wearing the same
yeah,
sunglasses.
Yeah.
So he's like, are these department issued, or
hey, do you guys all shop at the same place?
Same store?
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, yeah.
And so then he steals the guy's ID, and then at one point he sort of leaves his sunglasses for him as
yeah,
like a,
right,
it's
right.
just like a nice, like,
and then it comes
friendship
back at the
that
end,
develops between the two of them.
After he's lost Grodin yeah. to Marvin, he's sitting in the diner, and all of a sudden the sunglasses come sliding up to him.
Yeah.
It's like, oh, I've been looking for these.
Thanks, Alonzo.
Yeah. No, it's a beautiful movie. I'm glad you picked it. Like I said, I just watched it, like, literally, I think, 2 months ago.
Yeah.
But I was like, yeah, I'll watch it again.
Yeah.
I've got no problem with that, so.
Yeah, I probably watch it once every couple of years. I just reintroduced several friends of mine, Lacey Levitt and Steve Snowy, and a bunch of our friends, like, I had them over, and I was like, you guys have to, I need to introduce you to this, because
yeah.
it's great. And it was gratifying that they all loved it as much as I do, because I was, I was worried I was going to be
there's
like,
that
no, seriously, this is great.
Right,
you guys
yeah.
don't get it. It's really funny, but you know, they all really loved it.
You guys don't get it, but if you were smarter, you would laugh. So yeah.
But luckily, I have really smart friends, and
yeah.
I got it.
No, I've been trying to get some friends to watch it, and they're like, no, not interested. It's like, oh, come on.
Do it, Chris's friends.
Yes.
I'm assuming they listen to every episode of this podcast.
Yeah, they do. People just sit, you know, with bated breath waiting for these to come out. Anything else about Midnight Run you want to, before we run out of time?
I don't know. I mean, I feel like just people should go check it out. It's just like, it's sort of a lost genre.
It kind of is, yeah.
And it's a good one, and it really represents like what you like, a sort of a big budget, very audience friendly movie that doesn't underestimate the power of character development and building relationships between characters. And it just feels, it's a little sad to me how novel it feels now, that
yeah.
when you look back at it, because it just like, you know, people now, it's just about, you know, I think studios just say, you know, people don't go to movies for that, or they don't go to, they go to action movies to see explosions
right.
and CGI, and
yeah.
they don't go to see characters, and so they just don't put any importance on that. And I feel like it, you know, they're not mutually exclusive, and it's only going to improve your movie, and it doesn't cost anything to have good characters.
That's right. Yeah. Good point. Well said.
Yeah.
Well, cool. Hey, thanks for joining us today.
Thanks.
And where can you've got a Twitter handle, right?
I can't say I'm the most interesting person to follow on Twitter, because I'm more of a Facebooker, but
sure, me too.
But yeah,
but people can reach out to you there, so
they can reach out to me. I'm at the Cinechick,
and that's
T H E C I N E C H I C K.
Okay,
and and Lucky Them has like a web page from IFC. IFC is distributing it. It gets at SIFF this week, May 22nd, 23rd, and it's opening at in New York on the 30th, and it'll be on VOD same day.
Okay.
And awesome. It's at the Northwest Film Forum starting Friday the 13th, June 13th.
Friday the 13th,
yeah.
Really?
Yep.
Lucky, they couldn't give you
lucky day.
Lucky them on a lucky day.
So yeah, lots of ways to see it coming up.
That's great. Cool.
Yeah.
Thanks, Megan.
Thank you, Kris.
Until next time, remember, it's never too late to start thinking about the past.